Hello and welcome to 5 Minutes of Postgres. My name is Lucas and today we're going to talk about the new PgBouncer 121 release, which adds prepared statement support for PgBouncer when running in transaction mode. We talked about this previously in episode 73 of 5 Minutes in Postgres a couple months ago, and now this is actually released in a production version of PgBouncer. For those of you who don't know, transaction mode in PgBouncer is when PgBouncer reuses the same database connections for different transactions. Each time you do a begin or a commit or just a regular query, that essentially represents the boundaries where PgBouncer will keep the same connection for a particular client connection. But then once the transaction is finished, it will give it to the next transaction or the next query to be executed. That's a very important mode to run PgBouncer in, and so when you use PgBouncer in production settings, usually what I've seen people do is that they install PgBouncer on the database side next to the Postgres server as a way to scale connections in Postgres more easily, and then use it in transaction mode so that when you have a lot of connections from the client side, you don't need as many connections to the actual database server. Now, up until this release of PgBouncer, you could not use prepared statements in such configurations. So you couldn't benefit from things like the caching that Postgres does with query plans in prepared statements. As Greg Sabino Mullane describes on a Crunchy Data blog, this new release adds support for that. Let's dive in and take a look how that works. Greg starts by describing prepared statements. Greg ran a test here to check how much faster prepared statements are. And what he's testing here is essentially the fact that the planner will take a lot of time to come up with plans when there's complex joins involved. Here we're joining PG class with itself 14 times. So that's something where Postgres will spend a lot of time thinking about the optimal join strategy. And so that makes planning expensive. As you can see here in Greg's example, the first time you're getting planning time 170 milliseconds, next time you're getting very similar planning time, and third time also a similar planning time. Even if you run the same statement multiple times, you're not going to get any reduction in planning time. If you run this with prepared statements, on the other hand, you'll see that the first execution is slow, but then the second and third execution are fast. And that's one of the biggest benefits that prepared statements can give you, is that reduction in planning time. In PgBouncer's transaction pooling mode, previously, if you were trying to use prepared statements, it would actually complain with errors like this, where it would say, I don't know about this prepared statement. And really the issue here is that PgBouncer would not recognize what you're doing with prepared statements. And so it wouldn't guarantee that if you are trying to use a prepared statement in a transaction or in a query, it wouldn't necessarily have that prepared on the server side. Because what Postgres does on the server side is that prepared statements are local to each backend, to each process in Postgres. And so you must guarantee that you're going back to the same connection where that prepared statement existed, or you might need to re-prepare it. And so really the work that was done in PgBouncer was to add support for that so that PgBouncer can prepare statements correctly on the server side if needed, and it's transparent to the client. Greg wrote a little Perl test script here that essentially tests that prepared statement support. And so on the older PgBouncer version, this will give an error like this where it says prepared statements does not exist. Now in PgBouncer 1.21, when you set the new max prepared statement setting, this will let PgBouncer manage a certain amount of prepared statements on each connection on the server. Now, presumably, you wouldn't want to set this to a very high value because that would cause higher memory utilization on the database side. So 10 is probably a good starting point. You could probably go a little bit higher, I imagine, but I would watch the connection memory utilization closely. And you can see here that this Perl test script just works, right? So you didn't have to change anything. It just works. There are a couple of caveats that Greg mentions here, and I think they're very important. First of all, you can only use this with protocol level prepared statements. That means that depending on your client library, it may not work if it's not using those protocol level functions versus raw statements like execute and prepare. The second thing, and that's actually something I didn't know about, was that currently, there is no way to do a protocol level deallocate. Only in Postgres 17, which will come out next year, they added support for being able to close a prepared statement that was prepared through the protocol. That means right now, you will see issues with client-side drivers doing deallocate and that not working as expected. And so you will get errors like this. PgBouncer has a way to clean up the statements itself. So the problem isn't really on the database side as much as it is on the client side where you'll get these weird errors. On the Perl driver, there was a new method to skip the allocations to avoid these error cases. And so maybe we'll see other ORMs, other libraries also adopt a way to turn off the allocations because we trust PgBouncer to issue the deallocates for us. All in all, I think this is really cool. I also want to come back to the people who initially worked on this. We previously mentioned this, but Yalta on the PgBouncer team and Konstantin, they drove a lot of this effort to get this change into PgBouncer. You can see here, there were a lot of reviewers also on the PgBouncer PR. And so I think that just shows how much work was behind this. I'm just very excited to see so many improvements to PgBouncer recently, and I look forward to using this myself. Thank you so much for listening. This was 5 Minutes of Postgres. Subscribe to our YouTube channel to hear about next week's episode. Talk to you next week.